I gotta go. So welcome everyone to our annual Join conference, and welcome to my talk about visualizing Mandelbrot fractals using Riff and Spring Cloud Function and all kinds of other stuff. Very long title, and it is meant to be very enticing to be accepted at all kinds of conferences, so I had to figure out some way to make it look interesting. So I hope you find it interesting. Let's see. So my name is Dieter Hubot. I work at Ordina here as a practice manager, cloud automation. So what I focus on is getting the people trained in the cloud, cloud platforms, making people aware of what is possible in the cloud, working on some proposals for customers to get to the cloud and all that kind of stuff. So happy to be here. Let's talk about abstractions. In my other talk about Spring Cloud Stream, I always talk about abstractions and how Spring, for example, is very good at making abstractions and making it easier for developers to do stuff and actually implement things without worrying about sometimes the implementation details of boilerplate, etc. And in the cloud world, there's different kinds of abstractions that you can focus on. And we all know, until now, we all know most of these things, most of these concepts since the past few years. The infrastructure as a service, everyone knows them. There's the on-premise solutions like OpenStack, vSphere. We've all been through it. You got AWS, Google Cloud, Azure, the big players, Oracle Cloud. They're coming, guys. So they say. Then there's like a newcomer on the block a bit the last few years. He's been squeezing himself between the infrastructure and the platform as a service. It's called container as a service platforms. And you all have heard about Kubernetes. There's also DCOS and Docker Data Center. And every major cloud provider also has the solutions for a managed Kubernetes service, like Google Kubernetes Engine or Azure Container Service. And then we join the cloud platforms, which I've been talking about for a couple of years, like Cloud Foundry, OpenShift. I don't even know WaveMaker. I just stole this from the internet. But Cloud Foundry, OpenShift are the big ones. Heroku is one of the first ones to really offer it as a cloud solution to customers, to really regular users at home. And of course, you also have Pivotal, Cloud Foundry, etc. Now, there's software as a service I'm not even going to talk about. Everyone knows some software as a service that they use, like email or Salesforce, whatever. And then the newest abstraction in the wave of abstractions is a function as a service or function platform that are coming around. And there's a couple of more old ones in it, like OpenWhisk has been available for quite some time. That's pulled by IBM mainly. And all of you have heard about Lambda from Amazon Web Services. There's Google Cloud Functions and there's Azure Functions. I'll talk about Azure Functions. There's a link to an example of Azure Functions as well in the end. But basically, why are all these abstractions, why do they exist? There are so many service offerings, and everyone knows the higher in abstraction you go, so the more you go to the right, the less control you have. In software as a service, you just consume it, so you don't know, you cannot control it, you just use it. And in infrastructure as a service, you have to do everything yourself. So Dave Sire has a good quote about that, the guy from Pivotal. He says, the higher the level of abstraction, the higher the value line. So basically, what he means is that if you go higher in this level of abstraction, you create more value to the business. Infrastructure as a service by itself does not create value to the business. Software as a service, like that's the end goal, creates a lot of value for the business. He also said that not all abstractions are helpful for all the problems. So you cannot use these things for any problem. They all have their specific niche where they're good at. But all of them are certainly useful and I would say needed. Even function as a service, as I will explain. So function as a service, it's the highest abstraction layer if you don't for developers, for people that create software. And it actually uses functions as regular building blocks. So you don't create applications, you don't create containers or anything. Well, you do in the background, but you don't care about that. You just want to create functions, and you want to call these functions and chain them together and do stuff with it. As I said, Lambda, Azure Function, Google Cloud Function. And then now there's a new function as a service offering on the block. Last year in December, Pivotal announced Pivotal Function Service. So they rebranded a little bit their offerings. Pivotal Cloud Foundry is now a combination of Pivotal Application Service, Container Service, and Function Service. And they have their marketplace where you can have managed services on top of that. And they claim, or they do, support all the different kinds of clouds in like a multi-cloud platform. So why am I talking about Pivotal Function Service? Well, as I said, they announced it last year. It's still not quite done yet, but it's coming. So it's going to be part of their portfolio. And basically, they want to announce that they have an open source version or open source project, which will be the base of Pivotal Function Service called Project Riff. I'll talk about Riff a little bit later. But basically, Riff started as an open source project to easily have create functions and move them in some kind of cloud and then call the functions and stream data over these functions and get some value out of that. They initially had a couple of concepts and solutions, and they used Zookeeper and Kafka, etc., to move around messages between the functions, and they could auto-scale functions, etc. But after a while, they saw that Google was working on something very interesting as well, which could really help them remove all the boilerplate they had to do themselves. So you don't want to manage a Zookeeper, you don't want to manage a Kafka or some other message broker to run your functions. You would rather have this as a part of the platform. So they, I think Google even approached Pivotal in February or something of this year, and they announced in Google at Google I/O in July or something, they announced Knative. So this is a Google announcement. And so in February already, they were talking to Pivotal, like, we have this Knative thing coming up, and it's going to be to create building blocks, and it's going to help you deploy and run functions on Kubernetes together with Istio, and it can run on any cloud. And we'll have some Google stuff that makes it really good to run on Google Cloud, of course, but it will basically run on any cloud as long as you have Kubernetes. So that was the idea. So they worked together, and they immediately saw, like, all this stuff that we're doing in terms of boilerplate in Riff, we can just throw out and we'll use Knative for it. So a little bit more about Knative. They have basically four big blocks. One is called Knative Serving, where they offer the building blocks to really easily serve functions and make some functions accessible to the outside world, and also serving as in they can do load balancing and rate limiting, and it's based on a request reply model. So you call a function through a web interface or through message bus, and you can really easily get a response back. So that's Knative Serving. The second one is Knative Build, where they have a couple of components which lets you just pass your function code to Knative, and he will auto-detect what kind of code you have, either Java, Node.js, even Bash, simple Bash script, and it will create a container out of that, which can, with all kinds of sidecar containers in Kubernetes, and it can call your function and handle all the queuing of messages, the scaling, etc. The third component of Knative is a building block called Knative Events, which replaces the Apache Zookeeper and Kafka stuff, and it has like an abstraction for channels and subscriptions. And it basically has an abstraction because on different clouds you have different possibilities to do messaging. On Google Cloud, for example, they have an implementation for that. On Google Cloud, you can use Google PubSub, where you just publish subscribe on topics, and you can subscribe to the topic and get all the messages and produce it to another topic. But in Knative world, this is called channels and subscriptions. So, as I said, lots of abstractions again. A fourth building block of Knative is to make it run really smooth on Google Kubernetes Engine, so the other clouds cannot benefit from that. So, they have this Knative stuff, and Pivotal had their Riff open source project, so they said, we'll throw away all the old stuff that we had for all the boilerplate, and we'll just use Knative where possible, and we'll put our abstraction on top of it. And so there was a new version of Project Riff announced like 2 weeks ago on this year's spring one. There were some colleagues of ours over there. I think the talks are already on YouTube, so you can watch them. And this one is based on Kubernetes and Knative. So the project is called Riff because a guitar riff comes from the music world. A guitar riff is defined as a cluster or sequence of notes of chords that is used in a song. So riffs can be minor decorative elements that you use in a song, or they can be the basis of the entire song. So that's a bit the idea. The functions can be the basis of an entire application, and you can reuse functions where needed. This picture was actually taken last year in December at the big party at Josh Long's nice apartment. So I had the luck to be there. So it seems familiar. They were playing the guitar there, just riffing, I guess. That's what they call it, apparently. I'm not a music. I don't know anything about music, basically. So the lead of Project Riff is Mark Fisher. He's from Pivotal. If you look for his GitHub account, you will see lots of samples of different code snippets, functions in Node.js, Java, etc. So to explain more visually, so Kubernetes, for the people who don't know Kubernetes, it's an orchestration engine that can schedule and manage all your workload in Docker containers or in cloud native containers. And on top of that, do you have the added CRDs, as they call it, custom resource definitions. So Kubernetes was built to be expanded and extended, and you have alpha extensions and beta extensions, and Knative is basically still alpha extensions, and where they define new sorts of resources like the channels and the cluster bus, regular bus, cluster bus, all the kind of building blocks that you need. So it's still alpha, but probably it will become beta in a couple of months, and then it will become part of Kubernetes if it's allowed. So that's the idea, all the building blocks. So of course, everything of Kubernetes and Knative is completely open source. Google is the main driving force, but Pivotal, IBM, SAP, they have a lot of people working on it as well. Mainly because they all have Kubernetes offerings as well, of course. So on the other side, on the bottom side, you have the operators who are deploying and managing Kubernetes. So they have to operate and manage this Knative. So upgrade all the building blocks, make sure that everything stays up to date. Once it's mature enough, it will probably be included in Google Kubernetes Engine, like as a just as a tick box. You say, okay, I want Knative as well, and it will install everything for you. So that will be very handy. And basically, developers build on top of Knative. They make Knative resources. Knative actually uses Istio, which is the service mesh, to have all these kind of sidecar containers in your pods and to do all kinds of cross-cutting things. Like if you have a function, you build a Docker image around it, but all the polling of messages, queuing of messages, scaling of the function, that is handled in by Istio sidecar containers. For example, if a function receives lots of traffic, it is first accepted in the queue, and if the queue becomes too fast, too big, he knows, okay, I have to call another component that will scale my deployment and scale this function more up. So Knative serve, the serving part, which serves the functions, has this kind of option of you can go to zero instances of your function, so it doesn't run if it's not used. That's good money-wise, and it can scale to one, or it can stay at minimum one instance, so you don't have the cold boot or the cold start that you have in Java applications, unfortunately. And you can scale up to n instances, so as much as you want. You can put minimums and maximums for scaling. What I can say right now, it's still very bleeding edge alpha. It just changed a lot, so there's still lots of stuff not working, as I have experienced last weeks, and so many things will still change. But that's the basic idea of this setup. So you might wonder, like, what does it all mean? What can I do with it? It's too much information, and I agree, it's a lot to get into. But it's really good if you can separate the different components that are in this thing. So just let me show you. Doing okay on time, I think. So let me see. I'll make it bigger. Oh yeah, this. Can everyone see this, or should I make it even bigger? Is this okay, everyone? Okay. So basically, I can do kubectl get pods. This is connecting to my, or should be connecting. If this already did, okay. That would have been a disaster. So I have one pod running in my current namespace, which is the default namespace. It's a Mandelbrot web application. I'll show you later what that one does. But let's check all the deployments, all the pods, and everything is called eventing. So if you're a regular Kubernetes user, eventing is not a resource in regular Kubernetes. You will say, I don't know, a resource with the name eventing. So this is new, this is from Knative. And as you can see, there are three deployments. There's a Mandelbrot deployment, version one. There's a calculator, version one. And there's the Mandelbrot web deployment. These ones are not running. The web is just a regular Spring Boot application, so it is running. I can't scale it to zero. And so that's, you can see it over here. And this is something else to do, to create channels and subscriptions on GCP PubSub, so on the topics and channels and subscriptions on Google Cloud. So if we go a bit bigger and we get everything, which is now running on the entire cluster. So this is a Google Kubernetes cluster running just for my demo. So this is what is required right now for my really silly demo. As you can see, or not, that's a lot of stuff. Uh-oh. Let's go all the way down, yeah. As you can see, there's plenty of stuff running here in terms of deployments. So you have the Istio namespace, which is running everything controlled by Istio. If you know something, or if you have seen the talks about from Ray Tsang on DevOps, maybe he has a great talk about Istio. These are all the components that Istio needs to inject sidecars and control rate limit the requests to pods and etc. So that's a lot of stuff already. On top of Istio, you have to install the, well, when you install Knative, you install Istio and then Knative itself. This one has the three big components which I talked about. Build, which has a controller, the eventing also has a controller, and the serve part. They all have webhooks components. These are all really, really small pods, so it's not eating up huge amounts of resources, and they really want to work in the Unix way. If you guys know, what is the Unix way? Anyone? Yeah, do one thing and do one thing right. So they have all these, that's why they split it up. They want to have all these different components, which has one job, and they want to do that one job really well. Most of these things are written in Go, so they're really tiny and resource efficient. The regular kube system namespace is just for your Kubernetes engine. If you boot up a Kubernetes engine on Google, that's what you get already out of the box. There's what else is interesting out of this? There's two builds that have been run. So a build is also a concept from Knative. I have built my Mandelbrot function, version 1, Mandelbrot calculator function, also version 1. So you can have multiple revisions of functions, and you can build them whenever you want. There's some build templates. This is also from Knative. Already some images that I pushed. And then eventually here you have all the pods running. So this is all the running workload just to run my stupid demo. It seems a bit overkill, but it's part of a platform and it's meant to be used by lots of developers, lots of functions. So I think if you look at Lambda on AWS, for example, I don't want to know what runs behind it just to be able to run Lambdas for users. Okay, let's go back to the presentation. Takes a while to switch. So I wanted to have a use case to showcase, like, what can you do with functions, or why would you use functions? Dave Sayer, again, a big fan, so he has this diagram. I couldn't really find it because it's in his video on Spring.io or something, on a talk of his, and he talks about, will functions replace everything that apps do now? Will all the apps be broken up into functions? No, probably not, is what he says, and I agree. Probably you will still have applications, and he draws applications like some kind of spaceship, and behind the spaceship there's like a really big flurry or slur of all kinds of little components that are following this the spaceship, like some kind of string that is pulling all these little components with him, like a sort of cloud. And those are all the things that you can add to an application, or small tasks that you can pull out of an application that can be really that can scale separately when the workload is high, like sending out emails after batches, or doing batch jobs, or calculating stuff. All the stuff that you would put in a regular function. So I was thinking, what kind of function could I have a demo about? Something that is interesting to people, hopefully. So I thought about the most simple function in mathematics, as I said, but which creates the most complex object in mathematics. So Mandelbrot, most of you have heard about it. It's a really complex thing where you can keep zooming and zooming and zooming. You can go into infinity and it will keep generating really interesting patterns. So they usually talk about the Mandelbrot set, and the Mandelbrot set is the black part in this image. So it's everything that is in here. So, and on the top right, of course. So what the hell is a Mandelbrot? A Mandelbrot, this is, you can display it like you want. You can display it in full color. You can display it black and white, white and black. You can give meaning to the numbers however you like, or visualize it however you like. But this is basically the function which is the basis of all the of the entire image. And maybe the people who have done some mathematics in their life know that this is not like, it doesn't look like a regular equal signs. It's because, I don't know the exact name, but it indicates that you iterate over this function. So you solve this function, and the result of the function is fed back into the same function. And you iterate over this function over and over again. And basically, everything which is inside of the set is an imaginary number, like you know about the normal numbers, like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and doubles in Java, and a double is just a normal number. And then you have imaginary numbers. If people still remember with the 2a plus ib or something, which is an imaginary number, and I squared equals minus 1, which blew everyone's mind and is really weird. Well, those kind of numbers you put into this function, and the ones that, if you keep iterating over them, the ones that stay below basically 2, I think it is, they are inside of the set. All the ones that converge to infinity, so the ones that are fed into this function and keep growing and growing to infinity, they are out of the set. But what was really interesting, if you have the picture in the beginning, it's like a gradient, right? It's from dark to light, or light to dark, however you make it. But the interesting part is at the edges. So at the edges, you have these really small floating numbers where all the magic happens, and where they converge to infinity or not, based on like really tiny differences. And that's how you get these patterns. So how they say it is, the Mandelbrot set complex numbers for which the function does not diverge when iterated over z. So if you keep feeding it back in, you want to see if it converges or not. This is more complex, but yeah, some kind of guy said, okay, this Mandelbrot guy, he invented this. I give him the honor. So from then on, it was called the Mandelbrot set. And a lot of people, or like the math geeks, say it's the most complex object in mathematics. There's a video in the links at the end where there's 2 hours of zooming like this. And it just keeps going deeper and deeper. We must go deeper. Well, it keeps going deeper. The hard part is, the deeper that you go, the more iterations you need to do. If you stay on the top level, you only have to do a couple of iterations to know if it's going to be in the set or not. Then you get like really base image. The deeper you go, the more iterations, the more computing power. So if you want to, they generated this 2-hour video of zooming. They had like a complete server farm running 80 hours or something to make the video. So it's quite complex calculations. People who had a really early computer had these, probably these kind of small programs that showed basic stuff, and if you went 3 zoom levels in, it was already too much for your Pentium or whatever. So it's kind of cool. So how did I do this? I made a big mistake. I have to start my visualization because it takes too long, and it will probably not be finished. Yes, that was my mistake. That's why I added the... Oh, you cannot see it. Shit. So as you can see, it's starting. Oh, and I didn't think about the crappy projector, but it's gonna... It's not really gonna rub off here. But if you could look really closely, it's calculating all the pixels and sending requests to Google Cloud to the function on Google Cloud. Like, it's a 400 by 400 image, so it's doing 160,000 web requests to Google Cloud or something. So it takes a while. And I'll get back to it later, but there are ways where I want to improve on that. So let me show you my function. I don't know why he's not showing it mirrored now. And I'll change to my white background. Come on, okay. This is better. Okay, so this is my function. So it's quite not that simple, but because I work with the fluxes and you have to do some extra stuff. If you've seen Project Reactor, fluxes can be quite verbose, but if you look inside here, in this part, you basically calculate over the amount of iterations if it goes over, if the absolute value of this z value is over 2. If it is, you can return it. And if you are over 2 in the third iteration, you return 3. If you are over it in the last iteration, like 255, you return 255. And then I base my colors on top of that. And then you iterate. And you just complete the function, and you return the pixel. I need to add the x value and the y value so you still know if you return the value where to put the pixel. But that's basically all it does. So how do we get this in Riff? So if we look here, and oh, I'm on the bottom. Riff, service list. I'll just do it again. List. So it says, at the moment, Mandelbrot calculator is not running because it doesn't have any traffic, so it's scaled to 0. I'll talk more about that one later, but this one is the function that I just showed, and it's just running, of course. If I pull in my other screen, because it won't mirror my screens. So this one is happily going. You can already see a small line here. I'll show you. Come on. At the moment, he has one deployment now. He didn't have a deployment before, so he's now running this deployment. As you can see, there's 3 containers running in that one pod. And let me just take this one. Come on. And we'll kubectl describe this pod. Jesus. There you go. So the pod has lots of configuration. It's all done by the framework. So as you can see, it has multiple containers, which is the user container. The user container is a pullable image, which I built before. So I'll show you how I build it in a bit. So that's the actual container running the actual function. Then you have a queue proxy, which is something from Knative Serving. So it's a proxy to queue all the messages. And then there's the Istio proxy. So this Istio proxy to do rate limiting and all kinds of other stuff. I don't know enough about Istio to give you some detailed explanation because it's like all really hard stuff. And all quite new. Tom will probably tell you more about Istio. You can ask him. And these are all the things that happened. So all these things is for Istio and for the platform to work. It pulls the 3 images down. And you can see that this image is coming from my GCR project. So Knative, Istio, Riff, Mandelbrot. It pulls down the image and it runs it in a container. And then it is invoked by by my web application. Okay. I'll show you how we can build this. So I'm in my Mandelbrot function. As you can see, it's a regular Maven, regular Maven application. You build it. There's a jar coming out of it. This is really hard typing like this. So there's a regular jar coming out of it. And if you want to build this, you basically go ref function create jar, yes, and then you give the name to a function, you give a Git repository, so that's my Git repository, and you give it the name of an image, the Docker image, and you need to have, so you can either go to Docker Hub and publish there, or you can publish to the Google Container Registry, so any Docker registry is fine. You need to be logged into that registry to be able to push, or there needs to be a secret in Kubernetes which can push to that registry, which is part of the setup. And you need to add the handler. So you need to say in this jar, because it's going to find a jar. In a jar, this function is the one that I want to invoke when I call this container. So I do this, he'll complain because it already exists. And I don't want to delete it now because it's running, of course. But if I would do this, he would just start building the container by pulling in the source. It's all happening on the Knative part, Knative build. It will pull down the source, detect what kind of language you have. It will use the Java invoker, which I can show here. This is built by Project Riff. So they have all these different kinds of invokers that you can implement. God damn it. I need to put it here. Thank you. So this is part of Project Riff is a Java function invoker, and you have different options. You can just invoke a jar and say it's this class that you have to invoke, which needs to be a function, Java util function. You can say this is a jar and it's a Spring Boot application, so you want to add a main function. So this way it will know, oh, I have to run this pod, or I have to run this container as a Spring Boot application, and you can use a Spring context, and you can do more advanced stuff than just a regular plain Java function. So you have all the good stuff from Spring Cloud Function that you can use in Riff. And you can do versioning if I want to create a new function. Okay, that was maybe silly of me. Of course I can create a function if I just give it v2. Where's my... Okay. Let's do it like that. So now the function in itself will be called Mandelbrot v2. And of course, if you want to do versioning, you have to really build from source again. You have to do the revise command or something. But I don't have any changes to show you. So I'll just make a different function with version 1. Does not have the ready revision. As I said, it's alpha. Now it already exists. So let me... you create functions, but it actually also creates a function and a service. So you have to delete the service, in fact. Mandelbrot v2. And let's try again. I don't know why. Sometimes it fails. And again. I can do the exact same command. And now it works. So it's... alpha, bleeding edge. If you can see, it goes pretty fast. It has a container called it's the init containers. If everyone has used Kubernetes before, you can define a deployment which has a pod which has multiple containers, but you can also define init containers which are called before your actual container starts. Some people use it to initialize a database, for example. We do it in a customer like this. And this one, if you create a function and you add the Git repository, he will actually pull down the code from GitHub and initialize with the Java invoker. He will take the Java invoker's Docker file, etc. He will get the image from that Java invoker from Docker Hub. And he will add my actual jar. So I didn't have to add anything for that. He auto-detected this. And the invoker knows where to find a Maven jar. It's in the target folder, of course. Blah, blah, blah. He adds the target. He adds the function jar there. And then I think he should push it, which happened. Build step, build and push. So he should have pushed a new image. Let's find out. If we go to Kubernetes engine, this is all the workload. So this is the same as in my console. We can check out the registry. Container registry. If someone can help me out why it's still in Dutch, I cannot get it to English. I changed my language everywhere. It keeps putting it back in Dutch. And it doesn't really look fancy then. Mandelbrot V2, when was it made? 12 hours, 14 hours? I think 1 minute ago? Yeah, okay, so that's the one. So because in my Docker, he still takes V3. So he pushes the Docker image, and then he can run the function. So if we go back to this one, you'll see, or you won't see, the V2 should be here, but it's not. As I said, it goes wrong a couple of times. I don't know why he couldn't push. Anyway, let's show the application which does the web app. It's over here. There we go. So this is a simple Spring Boot app with a Docker file. I start from GRE OpenJDK 8, GRE Alpine. I add my jar and I run the jar. In the POM file, you can see it's version 0.0.4 snapshot already. And I have a YAML file which deploys this on Kubernetes, which is taking this image from GRE, from the registry. And runs it on port 8080, and then I have to expose this on Kubernetes, where I say, okay, make a service which points to the Docker container or the pod with the name Mandelbrot Web, expose port 80, and use the type load balancer. So in Kubernetes engine, it means that you will get an IP address connected to this automatically. You will have a load balancer, and it will direct you to the pod. So that is why we have this. Okay, it's already halfway. It's not bad. Yes?
So, will the function that is doing the calculations, will there now be multiple instances of that function running?
Yes, so that's another fun part. The as you can see, there's only one pod running here. And sometimes it scales up and sometimes it doesn't. I think I'm sending enough requests right now at the moment. It's receiving requests, by the way. So if you look at the logs, I'll do clear. I have to specify the container, of course. So let's see, user container. That one doesn't say anything because I don't want to make a log line for those 160,000. But as you can see, it's a Spring Boot application. They added the Rift thingy. So I didn't create this. They have the Java function invoker that calls our function. So and at startup, he does all kind of stuff with the function. He finds the function from the jar file in your Docker image, and he executes that function and makes a Spring application context, etc. So this started up in about 2 seconds, so that's not too bad. So the if you compare it to AWS Lambda, Lambda can take about 30 seconds or a minute, depending on if you use a Java implementation, to start up the GVM, etc. So this goes a bit faster. And if you leave it running at one instance, it will already be started up, so it doesn't have the cold boot. Yes?
So it's running the complete Spring Boot context just for one function.
Yes. But if you look...
How much resources?
The resources are not that bad, but it's, as you said, a Spring Cloud function, which is highly optimized. It's a very small Spring application context. I think he even uses a specialized application context for that. So Dave Sire has a complete talk about that. Let's talk about performance. I think it's already online from 2 weeks ago, so you can have a look. And he really drills down where can we save time and resources to make it really, really small. And there's, of course, the new Graal VM from Oracle coming, which can compile your Java code to really the target platform, like Linux on Docker containers, and it can make your applications really small. You get a single executable file, just like in Go or in C Sharp or whatever, a single AXE, as it were, and it really runs your application much faster. So you have faster boot up time and less resources consumed because you don't have to run the JVM, you don't have to run the bytecode processing, etc. You can see it. I'll show it more visually. You can see it. Sorry, I have to find my screen. Anyone who has seen talks by me knows that I always jump around. It's not most fun to see, but yeah, it's my way of working. It's in workloads. You should be able to see the function here, which is called, yes, this one. So this is the pod running, and the pod is using 200 megabytes. It's a lot. Exactly. So that's why they have other implementations, Node.js, Go, Bash, whatever. You have lots of overhead, but it's not all about resources. It's about speed and delivering value, etc. And money? I don't know about money. If it's... I know what you mean, but you can optimize things. You can use other languages if you want. But if you want development speed, it's really fast, right? And of course, the more functions that you run, the happier the cloud providers are, and the bigger the functions are in terms of resources, the happier they are. So it's up to us to make sure it's performant. But there are ways to get it more efficient. I can show you the... this is the actual pod. So this is all part of Google Kubernetes Engine. It's really cool. Makes it really easy to see what's happening. And I lost my train of thought now, Sergey. Thank you, Sergey. No, it's okay. It's okay. Let's go here. but it's a valid question. Yeah. So what does the web application do? Well, not much. It's using a WebSocket. So there's a really simple index HTML file here that you can see. It doesn't do a lot. It just has a new WebSocket, and it opens the WebSocket and sends really stupid calculate this size of a Mandelbrot. And it opens the WebSocket, and all the events that it gets back is part of the pixels, right? Like XY is 5. And it draws the... So I want to improve this and make it even fancier with colors and everything. But basically, it makes a WebSocket connection with the front end. If you open the WebSocket, it starts sending the the request to the function. So like 160,000, and it uses all reactive stuff for this, so that it goes quite fast. It doesn't always make the code much more readable, but it's all on GitHub. You can check it out. It subscribes to each result of the HTTP request, and then it sends it as an event through the WebSocket connection. I had to put in some buffering and rate limiting. I have some rate limiting here, like really simple. this flux of all these coordinates, like the 160,000 coordinates and then the 400 by 400 image, only send every 50 milliseconds. If I make it smaller, he goes through 1,000 WebSocket TCP connections really fast, and then my Mac explodes. So you can only have like 1,024 open file descriptors or something in Mac, and then he starts complaining and your JVM crashes, so I had to put some rate limiting in. But that's not really the point of the thing, right? I know that it's not really efficient to draw a Mandelbrot fractal going to a backend for each pixel, but it's to show what you can do with functions. And so the code you can check out whenever you want. Let's go back to what we have learned. It's really, so this is a comment I made last night, 14 hours ago, so maybe 20 hours ago, that the build pack that they give doesn't work if you use Flux and everything. So there's lots of bugs, there's lots of new stuff, lots of questions why it doesn't work. So what did we learn today? That Bleeding Edge is not stable. It's a really cool platform. It has lots of capabilities, lots of promises. But I would rather want a much mature solution, of course, if I want to use it in the enterprise. I'm really looking forward to seeing what Pivotal Function Service is going to look like. Are they going to make it really easy to create functions, like in a visual way with the CLI? They already have the CLI, but it's using the CLI is very cumbersome, lots of errors. So in that case, it really matters to contribute and just report at least everything that goes wrong. So I try to do that, and I have some issues already open to them, even to Knative and to the project Riff. So it helps if you just report issues. And I'm starting to see more and more contributions on the project there. So the issues are rising, but they are getting solved as well. I'll share these resources. I'll share the presentation afterwards as well, so you can look what Riff is, more details about Riff, or how to install it on Google Kubernetes Engine. There's a really good guide that you just follow and you set it all up. Big read about Knative. Istio is a separate beast, which I want to really dive into later, but it's also a lot. This explains why Pivotal chose for Knative to use it on our platform and everything, more information. And this is the explanation of Google, why they want to be the best partner to go serverless. They have lots of solutions with Google App Engine, etc. This is the cool talk by Dave Sire, where he explains why functions are useful and why you don't have to put functions for everything, which is a bit silly. And this is just a cool video of if you have 2 hours to spare to just look at the zooming. Maybe I can end with it. It's actually quite cool. So we are already an hour and a half in, and it goes to 10 to the 2011th power of iterations for each pixel. So that's why it takes like 80 hours on a server farm to generate this video. But it just keeps going and going and going, and there's some music. So if you want to become really serene, this is a good solution. Or if you want to eat mushrooms or everything. That's what everyone was thinking, right? So that's about it for my presentation. Are there any questions that I will try to answer them? Probably many or none, one of the two. No questions. You'll have to read a lot, I guess, if you're interested, and check it out. Okay. Thank you.